Si quieres ver el mismo video en español, albo po polsku, or in other languages, mira la descripción abajo.
In this episode, we'll talk about one of the most original characters in cinema history. An amazing character, Master Yoda is. In Star Wars, we saw him as an old man, a sage, a great teacher, a skilled warrior, a nimble acrobat, a traveler, a ghost, a madman. All of these attributes are interesting, but today we'll focus on his peculiar way of speaking. Yoda has appeared in each of the movie's trilogies and in animated series. However, in this video I will cover his most canonical appearances from the first two trilogies. Maybe English is not his native tongue, but surprisingly, Yoda doesn't make any mistakes when it comes to pronunciation. All of his phonemes are pronounced rather correctly, even the tough ones, like th.
Train yourself to let go of everything you fear to lose. Of everything you fear to lose.
Master Yoda is the oldest character in Star Wars, with a few exceptions. He's about 900 years old in the movies.
When 900 years old you reach, look as good you are not,
And as befits a very old man, he sometimes uses very archaic English constructions.
Size matters not. Look at me. Judge me by my size, do you? Size matters not.
Here, Yoda is using a direct negation, a not negation, instead of the present simple tense negation, which a typical English native speaker would use today. That is, size does not matter, or size doesn't matter. Yoda's simple negation was once very common. Today in English it is still used in poetry or when we want to give our utterance an archaic overtone. Or when other ways of negating a sentence don't match the song's melody. The same way of making a character sound more archaic, through direct negation, was used in another movie trilogy, by a character who was at least several times older than Master Yoda.
The line was broken years ago. It matters not. The world of men shall fall.
In episode 5, The Empire Strikes Back, Luke arrives on the swampy planet Dagobah in search of the great Master Yoda. Luke encounters Yoda very quickly, but as a test of Luke's patience, Yoda does not reveal his true identity. He pretends to be harmless madman. It is at these moments that we hear a bizarre form of Yoda speech. Yoda starts to emit the verb to be. Yoda says,
"How far away is Yoda? Will it take us long to get there?"
"Not far, Yoda, not far."
Instead of, "Yoda is not far," or, "Yoda isn't far." This construction is simply not correct in English. However, there are languages in which the verb to be, or more generally speaking, the copula, is less common. For example, "Yoda, not far," could be translated word for word into Chinese. In English, this sentence is not correct. But in Chinese, "Yoda bu yan" is completely fine. And this sentence will sound perfectly correct to a Chinese native speaker. But we don't have to go that far. Even in a language that is way closer to English in both genetic and geographical terms, in Russian, copula is also not used, at least sometimes in the present tense. For example, in Russian we can translate Yoda's sentence word for word, and we'll get "Yoda недалеко," which is correct. Okay, we've already seen one trick that makes Yoda sound like a very old man, and another one which makes him sound like a madman. Now we're coming for the last one, the most important one. This one will reinforce both attributes. We'll talk about word order and syntax. Yoda very often utters sentences that are, to say the least, bizarre. The words of these sentences are reshuffled, but the sentences remain comprehensible. For example, Yoda says,
"Truly wonderful the mind of a child is."
Instead of, "The mind of a child is truly wonderful." Yoda also says,
"Good relations with the Wookiees I have."
Instead of, "I have good relations with the Wookiees." In these examples, Yoda just used a non-standard English word order. But what do I mean when I say standard English word order? To understand this, we first need to go back to grammar lessons from secondary school. Any English sentence in which the most important verb is transitive can have two constituents that are called subject and object. We can treat the subject as the agent or performer of the verb, action, while the object is the recipient of the verb. We have to be careful because such definitions will not work for many languages. Actually, it's not even enough in English.
But for this simple sentence and for Yoda's dialogues, we're fine. You also have to remember that subjects and objects are not necessarily single words. These might be a group of words, like in this case, we have the and cat, or even long clauses. We'll see more of these when we have a look at Yoda's dialogues. Because of how sentences in English are ordered, subject, verb, object, we say that English is an SVO language. Yoda speaks English, but very often does not follow this standard English word order. But we know that Yoda is nuts, but normal people and normal languages use this normal word order, or do they? This order is indeed used by English and many other European languages, by the vast majority of European languages, and actually around the world as well. But there are other options as well. Many Indian languages, for example, use an SOV order. The cat drinks milk in Hindi is Billi doodh peeti hai, which literally means the cat milk drinks. So we just saw two possible orders, SVO and SOV. Now the question is, are there any other possible word orders? Well, theoretically, there are six possible permutations if we take these three elements. Here they are. It turns out that for each permutation, there's at least one language that uses this word order. And this is how often they are represented by world languages. Now, to be clear, a word order is never something rigid in a language. A given language allows for many word orders, but usually this one word order is dominant. English is no exception. Let's take an example. Andrew needs time is a typical English SVO sentence. But when we want to ask about the object of the sentence, we suddenly reshuffle the words quite a bit. What does Andrew need? And we consider this to be 100% correct in English. We never think about this, it's just natural for us to use inversion in questions. But if you think about it, it's not really super logical. Now, have a look at Chinese and how logical Chinese is, at least in this example. The same sentence about Andrew in Chinese would be
安德鲁需要时间.
And now if we want to ask about the object of this sentence, we would pose this question.
安德鲁需要什么?
Literally, Andrew needs what? That's it, Chinese is just quite logical. Anyway, the English language and many European languages that are close to us belong to this first group, SVO. But this group includes also quite exotic languages too, Chinese, Vietnamese, Hebrew, Indonesian, and others. The latter group that we saw when we talked about Hindi is also super big, almost as big as SVO, and it also includes very big languages. Practically all languages of the Indian subcontinent, Persian, Korean, Japanese, Turkish, etc. In one of the previous videos, I talked about how languages and all their attributes evolve. The grammar, pronunciation, vocabulary, the syntax, the word order is no exception, and it also changes across the centuries. For example, Latin, in which Cicero wrote, is an SOV language. But for some reason, the daughters of Latin, the Romance languages, Spanish, French, Portuguese, Italian, and others, morphed into SVO languages. Now, the other four combinations are much less common around the world. And again, we would ask why. We'll talk about this in the next video. Some sources even claim that the two rarest orders, OSV and OVS, actually don't exist, or rather, they are not a standard order in any language. The languages that supposedly use these orders are the poorly researched languages of small communities, mainly in the Americas. And interestingly enough, Klingon is an OVS language. Now, of course, we have Master Yoda who uses his weird word order, or orders. But yeah, which orders does he use? Yoda's strange orders are usually OVS or OSV. Let's have a look.
I am ready. Ben, I can be a Jedi. Ben, tell him I'm ready.
Ready, are you?
Last, the Jedi are no more.
Not if anything to say about it. I have.
The chosen one, the boy may be.
Strong is Vader. Strong is Vader.
At an end, your rule is. And not short enough it was.
A
the scriptwriter or the linguist who wrote down the dialogues of Yoda, cleverly enough chose these two rarest word orders. In this way, Yoda sounds really foreign to us. But surprisingly, sometimes Yoda decides to use this standard English word order.
Nani?
I cannot teach him. The boy has no patience.
Fear is the path to the dark side. Fear leads to anger. Anger leads to hate. Hate leads to suffering.
It's not coincidence that Yoda used this standard syntax in the last three questions. Thanks to this, it's easier to see how fear leads to suffering. That is, fear leads to anger, anger leads to hate, hate leads to suffering. Everything goes in one line or in one direction, and together with time. And this is how these phrases would look like had Yoda chosen his favorite OSV word order. To anger, fear leads. To hate, anger leads. To suffering, hate leads. In this case, it would be a bit tricky to focus on what leads to what, as you can see on the diagram. Maybe Yoda just wanted to sound more accessible to his student, or maybe the scriptwriter just didn't want to confuse us too much. Perhaps the Nation of Yoda, from which we know only three representatives, speak a language that uses a different word order. And Yoda, not being a native English speaker, simply starts using his native language's features in English. This phenomenon actually has a name. It's so-called language transfer. The victims of which we all are. Well, at least if you try to speak a foreign language. It is in our human nature to try to pigeonhole and classify everything we can, and languages can't escape that. On one hand, it's helpful because when we see the label SOV, then we know what to expect from a given language in terms of the syntax. But on the other hand, such simple labeling will not give us any knowledge about the nuances and the deep details of a language. For example, maybe word orders in English and my mother tongue, Polish, are the same. But it is very difficult for an English speaker to grasp and to feel that Polish translation of this English sentence, a man sees a lion, can in theory use any of the possible six permutations that we saw in this video. Człowiek widzi lwa, człowiek lwa widzi, widzi człowiek lwa, widzi lwa widzi człowiek, lwa człowiek widzi. All of them sound correct to me, but such permutations in English would change the meaning or would make the sentence incorrect. My dear viewers, if you want to feel it,
learn Polish.
This example might look scary enough, but Polish and English are actually two quite close languages. They come from the same linguistic family. Imagine the problems that we can get if we go to a language which is way different. In this video, we talked about subjects, objects, verbs, so that we could understand what was happening in Yoda's speech. But there are languages where these concepts are just not enough, or they are way more difficult to use. Basque language. Now, to wrap up, all other things being equal, the less related the language, the more of its aspects will be foreign to us. When we start learning a language such as Japanese or Turkish, we must first unlearn what we've taken for granted.
You must unlearn what you have learned.
We can partially understand the difference of a given language through linguistic analysis like the one in this video. But to really feel a language, we have to learn it and start using it. This is why I encourage you to learn foreign languages, especially the distant ones. Learning them really forces us to question lots of stuff, and it's quite fun. Star Wars introduced so many great cultures and languages. Maybe you'd like me to analyze the languages of the Wookiees, or the languages of the astromech droids, or the language of the Ewoks, or the language of the inhabitants of the planet Gamor. Anyway, there will be more linguistic analyses on this channel. I already have a few ideas. Let me know in the comments what you'd like me to work on. And in the meantime, for anyone that is really interested in Yoda's speech, I'm leaving you a few very interesting links below. And for today, that's it. I'll see you soon.